My name is Michael Weigand. Since 2008, I'm a professor at the Technical University in Vienna, teaching machine elements, and there's a special focus about for transmissions for aviation. And before, I worked for 5.5 years for the company of ZF Aviation in Kassel in Germany, being responsible for helicopter gearboxes, especially the main gearbox of the H135. That was a big startup of production, and then further development, and responsible for some Tiger gearboxes, or small gearboxes, and others, transmissions. And I was responsible for the test stand business, comprising test stands for transmissions or helicopters, and also for rotor blades. So in my speech, I want to show you some work we do related to the topic of this conference, or a special focus about safety. And I want to tell you what we have done in the last years about lubricants. We had a presentation 3 years ago here, and I will show you what happened since then. So, at the beginning, as I assume that most people thinking of Vienna do not primarily think of helicopter transmissions and drive shafts, I want to give you an impression what we are doing there. Then some focuses on safety related work concerning the MGB, then some thoughts about safety assessment and FMEICA. Then we have a development together with a startup about detection of abrasion and status monitoring. We have a focus on freewheel operation, and then, as I mentioned already, a special focus on lubricants and loss of lubrications. So concerning transmissions of aviation, in teaching, we have in the master courses, we have special courses, theoretical lectures about transmissions for aviation, practical work in the laboratory, then you can do seminar works, bachelor theses, etc. And everything what we do in teaching and research is always done against the background of the EASA regulations and framework, especially the certification specifications, in this case, CSVLRs 27 and 29, because we think it's very important to make the students familiar as early as possible, because it takes some time to get familiar with all these regulations, to understand the argumentations, the work that has to be done. And so we want to teach it as early as possible. I was the first professor working on aviation at our institute. Now we have two additional professorships, one for tribology that is linked especially to the topic of the lubricants. And since May, we have a professorship for aircraft systems, Professor Behrens, who worked before for Airbus in Bremen. And one focus in teaching is to create a master course in aeronautics on university level. At the moment, we do not have, or did not have in Austria, and thus becoming on university level the focal point in Austria. But we will do this master course together with all our universities working on aviation, for example, especially TU Graz, for thermal turbomachinery, materials in Graz, and Leoben and air traffic management in Salzburg. We have a close link via tribology to the Austrian Excellence Center for Tribology. This is located in Wiener Neustadt, south of Vienna. And this is a research institution where about 150 people are working on tribology, especially today, is a very important topic. This is an overview about our memberships and representations. for us, especially important are the organizations related to drivetrain, technology, gears, bearings, shafts, etc. We have the Forschungsvereinigung Antriebstechnik, this is a German-speaking research unit or community mainly driven by the companies, and we are a little bit proud because we are the, thanks to COVID, I have to say, because everything is at a distance at the moment, we are a member of AGMA and also of the Aerospace Gearing Committee of, and we see the only Europeans and the only university. This is very important as we have nothing comparable in Europe. Then we are a member, naturally, a vertical flight society, the Austrian Aeronautics Industry Group. This is an industry organization, but there we can, at top level, we can talk about research topics, what has to be done. And we are representing Austria in the International Forum for Aviation Research. I will come back to that later. More a hobby of us or of me is, as I'm working on, as a volunteer on ground-based ambulances, is that we have together with the Austrian operator ÖAMTC developed a complete new interior for EMS helicopters called Cocon. This is a view in our laboratory for transmissions for aviation directly before the opening. So we have really a laboratory meeting the standards even required, and at least together with our national authority says that they, in the real right frame, allow us to do also the participation in certification and qualification runs. We are operating standard FZG test stands. This is especially for investigation of lubricants, balancing machine. This is a tail drive test stand we realized together with Airbus helicopters in Donauwörth to test the bearings of the tail drive shaft under definite loading conditions, and measured were temperatures and vibrations. This picture should only indicate that the control, complete control of the test stands is meeting industrial standards. To give you an impression, at this test stand, if it's powered on, you cannot push even an emergency button, but without being detected, all the signals stay saved in a, or stored in a safe space, and a controlled shutdown of the test stand. The largest test stand we have, a universal test stand, following as the motor. Then we are driving, we are representing, the idea is to simulate a tail rotor drive shaft of a turbine-driven helicopter. So we have a motor representing the turbine, the shafts, the gearboxes, the generator creating the torque load, and the power. Then we have electric power feedback. We have 300 kilowatts in this setup. If we use the motor to drive a mechanical closed loop test, we could realize a testing power of about 2 megawatts. This is the picture of this test stand built. For our investigations, we use a phased out transmissions of BO-105 helicopters. If you visit us at our booth, you can see the originals of these transmissions. Why these gearboxes? Because the most complicated parts in these helicopter transmissions are the bevel gears. So for our investigations at the moment, especially concerning lubricants, this is the best gearbox we can use. What we have done is a large industry project together with the company of Zörgler in the south of Vienna. Together we developed the complete drivetrain, main gearbox, tail gearbox, all drive shafts for the Russian civilian helicopter Kamov Ka-62. This is an impression of our partner company. This is the building of the test stand, and inside this is the test stand for the main gearbox with twice 2,600 kilowatts, one of the largest, as far as I know, largest helicopter main gearbox test stands in Europe, also being able or prepared to test coaxial rotors. In research, the largest project together with Technical University in Munich and Zörgler is a speed variable rotor drive system. And the idea is, because we need a larger range for tilt rotor tilt wing,
And a high-speed helicopter, we need a larger speed range that we can realize with the turbine alone. So the idea is to have a constant turbine speed, a variable rotor speed, then you have to change the ratio of the gearbox during flight. And in this project, we are in the second phase. The rotor system is handled by the Technical University in Munich, and the transmission is handled by our university and Zirkler. And final slide about the activities. In the International Forum for Aviation Research, we are leading a group about vertical lift, discussing future needs for rotorcraft. We see in the US, it's pretty clear the background for the future vertical lift program. But we see a lot like the RACER, like next generation civil tilt rotor, rotorcraft in concepts in Russia, mainly driven by, say, individual motivation. But sometimes it seems a little bit that somebody is inventing a medicine hopes that there will be the right disease for it. Our idea is to discuss together with 60 nations the common missions, requirements, etc., to define the need for rotorcraft. Then on continental level, we can argue for demonstrators, etc., and then on national level also we have good arguments. And we think that this is also important. If we see today's discussions, Horizon Europe, etc., then the main topic is decarbonization, and helicopters in total do not produce really a lot, or a very low percentage, so we need very good arguments to get money for our topics. We are participating here as university because we think we have a unique view on rotorcraft transmissions and the safety, because we have a different view than OEM and operator and authorities, but we are familiar with all the framework, the guidance material, etc., and thus we think we can contribute to these activities of the rotorcraft safety roadmap to bring in our expertise, and that's also our motivation to get a feedback from you if you think our approaches are correct. So one topic we tackled was there was an EASA call about the integrity improvement of rotorcraft main gearboxes. We submitted a proposal together with partners. We were not chosen, but we still think that we have a rather comprehensive and suitable approach for this topic, and which could also be applied to other transmissions, and I will come back to that a little bit later. Concerning safety assessment, EASA has started the NPA 2021-11 about the safety assessment process. We are willing to contribute to this, and one activity looking at the FMECA is that based on an accident report of an accident in 2012, we looked at the process of the FMECA and developed made a diploma thesis where we looked if this works, that we tested the concept for modular FMECA and also a software-supported FMECA to ease the process in the design department. And at least to our impression and experiences, it might be good to have the FMECA better integrated, especially in the face of the continued airworthiness, because that would help to make this, we would propose for made failure modules, so because the bearing has always the same failure modes, and by also looking on the FMECA and the continued airworthiness, you can improve and make more mature all these modules and the whole FMECA. Then, another thing, detection of abrasion chip detection, the rulemaking task 725 was initiated by EASA to improve the chip detection in rotorcraft gearboxes. There we also would like to contribute, And reading this text, for me at least, for parts, I think this it's not realistic. To do, for example, a chip detection test for each possible part that can cause a critical incident, I have done it for one stage gearbox for one point that needed nearly 1 year. And I think it's to do this for all points of a large gearbox, for example, I think is not on one hand very suitable. And on the other hand, I will come back to that. I think we have a much more challenging situation. However, concerning chip detection, two former students of us have founded a startup company. And they have developed and also proved the concept of a chip detector that is not only able to indicate the chip itself, but it will also directly answer the most interesting question which we get when somebody has a chip, because then we say, is it a hard chip or is it not? Because if it's a hard chip, it might come from a bearing or a gear that might be critical. And looking on some magnetic effects, they realized a chip detector that directly indicates is it hard material or not. And the idea is to have this also as a retrofit solution for existing transmissions. And what I just mentioned is, I think what is much more challenging is that there was a fatal accident in 2016 where there was no indication of abraded chips, because before the part completely broke, there were only a few pittings. So, and this means that the challenge is, a major challenge for me is not that we have to prove that we get early enough the chip, the indication, but that we have maybe have to find other ways to detect such, not via chips, but on other solutions to detect these chips early enough. And this was also integrated in our proposal for this MGB integrity improvement, and naturally we are still willing to contribute to this topic. Free wheel operation is our observation. Free wheel clutches are always a very sensitive transmission part. As you might know, we have compiled all the available information about these components, operational experience, and also several incidents. And also the freewheel engagement. If, for example, you have a two-turbine drivetrain with a FADEC combining both turbines, it's not so clear how the engagement and disengagement process works. In order to investigate these situations, we have a concept for a test rig. And what was mentioned also in the presentation before, if you operate a helicopter with intended single engine operation, this means that one freewheel is in an overrunning mode for a longer time. And as the sprags are always have contact with these raceways, this has at least to be proven that there is no detrimental effect by this operation mode. A very special topic, and this is also a little bit related to our OEMs, freewheel clutches with piston engines, because then we have the problems of torsional vibrations. Now, the special focus of this presentation about lubricants is, these are some basic information. I don't want to mention every word. These are some excerpts of a presentation of Giuseppe Gasparini, a presentation about the main gearbox of the AW139 in 2007. So we have the requirements listed here, that we have high-speed stages, low-speed stages, which by itself have different requirements. And at the moment, we have the compromise in most gearboxes that we operate the helicopter transmissions with turbine oils and mostly against the specification of mil-spec 23699. But it is a compromise. And 14 years ago, Gasparini said, we hope
that the customers will recognize this fact and they will take the burden to handle more lubricants. As we see it since the last years, we think the problem is more on the commercial side to make this to make a lubricant available all over the world and to with the amount required to make it also a business case for the supplier. Before here and here, this I highlighted the main problem because for the extreme pressures in bearings and on gear flanks, which is about 1,500 megapascal, we need special agents or additives so that these large molecules of the oil are not cracked and they are missing in the engine oils used. And this leads in a lot of cases to surface deterioration, for example, of bearings especially and gear flanks. What we made together with the professorship of tribology is that as we also observed that oils meeting the same standard show different behavior. We investigated the chemical composition of these lubricants and found a correlation about their performance against micropickings, gray stippiness, pitting, and also fretting. And now, before the background, what I said already is that then the idea came up to develop new additives together. We also our faculty for technical chemistry. These are so-called ionic liquids. And they were developed and tested successfully on FZG test benches especially. And we did it with reference oils because we wanted to have the mostly neutral oil to see really the effect of these additives. What we, among other features, saw that the friction coefficient came down remarkably. And to give you an idea, these additives are about 5% of the total oil volume. And the idea now is, in the next step, that we want to find out, because I think, especially with all these certification, qualification aspects, et cetera, we want to find out if we can mix these additives with the existing oils to improve the lubricant, because then we would not have the problem with the commercial situation and could hopefully improve the performance. Although as an engineer and looking at safety, and I think I said it 12 or 9 years ago here on the symposium, for us it's difficult because safety is number one, but it's not that we define the best lubricant and the purchasing department looks for it. The other way around, we have to live with oils which are simply available. So that we will test these lubricants here on this already mentioned test stand. And there are further potentials like texturing of surfaces or very thin coatings, which will also be topics of our tribology department. Lubricants, loss of lubrication is also a topic. We know from one fatal accident that there was a rulemaking task regarding loss of lubrication following misinterpretations. Personally, I'm also not very happy with the outcome, but we would like, we're willing to support these discussions and also to ease the work of the engineers to find out about or to see the evaluate the loss of lubrication behavior of a rotorcraft gearbox. You need the gearbox. So this means you put it on the test stand and then you make the test. If you fail, it's too late to go back and redesign the complete gearbox. So although this is a really challenging task, we want to find ways to enable, to evaluate the loss of lubrication performance in earlier design stages before we have built the whole gearbox. This again, final slide is that, as we said, our motivation to be here is to discuss our ideas here with you, to get a feedback. and to get an answer how we can contribute, and ask us either here or comment it, or you are cordially invited to visit us at our test booth. So thank you for your attention.